Most likely you've heard Go is a great language for developing web applications. This statement is not without a reason. The Go language has many built-in features necessary for web development, like a high-performance HTTP server, HTML templating, form handling, or JSON encoding. It is also compiled down to a single binary executable, which makes the deployment to a wide variety of cloud services very easy. It might has even become one of the best choices for enterprise development, as many big companies, including Google, Apple or Facebook, adopted for running their web services. Hey guys, this is Philip with Go Web Examples, and in this video I'll be showing you how to create your first HTTP server and teach you some good coding practices that work really well for me when I create web services. This video is also part of a series I'm creating to cover the basics of web development in Go. So let us jump right in and create our first and very simple HTTP server. Bear with me, this first example is really simple and should just help you get the basic concept of it. We will go into more detail and proper project structure later in this video, so hang in if you are familiar with this already. To get things started, I've created and initialized a new Go module with a go-mod init command as usual. As the main function is the entry point of every Go program, let's just write our server in there. So we initialize our HTTP server by writing HTTP, listen and serve, then the port, which is going to be 8080 and nil. Now as we save the file, the .NET.HTTP package is automatically imported by our editor. Let me quickly explain what we've done. We've imported the standard Go package, which is .NET.HTTP, which contains all the things we need for HTTP stuff. The listen and serve function launches Go's default HTTP server on our desired port. The second argument, nil, is not that important for now. We will cover that later. Alright, that's basically it. We can run this program now by opening up our terminal and writing go run main.go. As we see, no errors, no output. Yes, our server is running in the background. We can open up our browser and see it's working. Yep, our server is handling our request. Well, pretty boring you might think, it serves nothing. Okay, back to our editor. Let's create a new route handler. We can do this by writing HTTP handle func. As the first argument, we put in the path we want our handler to be registered on, let's say slash hello world. And in the second argument, rewrite the handler function, which has the signature func w http dot response writer comma r http dot request. As the name implies, w is the response writer, where we write our response to, which also has methods, for example for setting the status code or the content type. R contains all information about the request, like the path, query arguments or possibly form values. In this new handler function, let's write w.write and then a string, hello world, which we have to cast into a byte array. Instead of responding with a plain old string, we could also use a JSON encoder to write JSON data to our response, or the HTML template package to respond with an HTML page. Let's open up our terminal again, stop our current server and execute it again. Now if we open up our browser and navigate to our registered path slash hello world, we can see that our handler works as intended. Alright, with that basic understanding of how to create an HTTP server, let's discard all of our code and start to write a proper HTTP server which actually does things. For our demo project, I like to write a REST API for managing a shopping list. We will create a few functions to get a list of our shopping items, add a new item to the list, and remove one. We will also use the JSON package for the encoding of our requests and responses. One thing I like to do is to create a new directory called API, which will contain the code for our REST API server. This serves the purpose of encapsulation, reusability and testability, as we decouple the server part from our main package. In that directory, we can create a new file and call it server.go. In case you didn't know, this file can have any name, but it obviously makes sense to call it server, as we write our server in there. We assign this file to our API package by adding the header line package API. Now for our shopping list items to be handled more easily, let's quickly create an item struct and then we will start with the interesting part, the server. Usually I put my entities into the root package of our application, but for the sake of ease and readability, let's create it right here. Our shopping list item contains an ID, which is not a normal integer, but rather a UUID from the Google UUID package. I prefer to work with UUIDs than integers, as we do not need a system which keeps track of the last one used, which would have to be incremented every time we use it. UUIDs are just random numbers in a pretty format. Our item also has JSON struct tags, which define how the keys in the JSON data should look like. Next, we create our server struct, which will compose the GorillaMux router and a data structure for our shopping list items. There are two things to note here, which are, first, we use the GorillaMux package as our router. Even though the servMux from the standard HTTP package is really good, the GorillaMux router adds a thin layer of comfortability on top, like method-based routes and path variables. Also to note here, our Mux router has no field name, so our server composes it. This means it inherits all methods from the Mux router itself. This is handy when registering routes and it also makes our server comply with the HTTP handler interface, so we can use it with many things of the NetHTTP package. Second, shopping items is just a slice of items. Because of that, it might not be safe for concurrent access and could potentially break if we have dozens of incoming requests at the same time. But in our case, it's fine, as this just serves as a demo. In real applications, we wouldn't even store our data directly in the server struct. It would rather be a connection to a database or something like that. Let's create a function to initialize our server struct to get things going, which we will call new server. Now that the initialization function is done, we can write our route handlers. The first one, which will be the create shopping item handler, we will write together, and the others I'm going to paste in to not bore you with that. The special thing about this function declaration is that it returns a closure. This is a pattern I've been using for a while, which I first seen in a blog post of Matt Ryer, very skilled guy. It has one key advantage. When it's called for the first time, we have some space to initialize stuff or declare types, which are only relevant for this particular method. As it's called only once, we could for example also parse an HTML template. In our case, we don't really need this right now, but I like to keep things consistent. Now we can go ahead and use the JSON package to read the request body and decode the JSON into our shopping list item like this. As we expect our user to only give us the name of the item, we generate a new UUID for it and then add it to our shopping item slice. With that done, we can write back the full item encoded as JSON data to our user. We also set the content type to application JSON, so the user, or rather a client, knows what kind of data it gets. That's basically it for the route handler. Let me paste in the other ones so we can go through each briefly. List shopping items, as the name implies, just encodes our shopping items into a JSON and returns that to the user. Remove shopping item removes an item from the shopping list. It does that by parsing the UUID from the request path, then ranges over all stored items, and when the item is found, it cuts it from the slice and saves it back. This handler also has no response. The indication of the 200 OK HTTP status should be enough for that. With the handlers done, we have to attach the handlers to a route, like we did in the very first toy example. For that, I like to create a small helper method, which we call after initialization of the server struct. So let's do that by creating the method routes. And call that function in the initialization with s.routes. Alright, if we didn't miss anything, our server is now done. We can go back to our main file and call it from there. So let's write srv equals api.newserver http.listenandserve port 8080. And now for the second parameter, we can put in our server here, srv. Now with everything done, let's run our server and see if there are any errors. Nope, no errors. So we're good. In my VS Code, I have this REST plugin installed. With that, we can go into this shopping.rest file I've prepared and test our server. Let's run the first request to get a list of our shopping items. As you can see, this list is empty as expected. For the second request, we can give it some JSON data and create our first item. This also did work, and we get back the item we've created. Let's create another one just for good measure. Hey, we've added Pasta to our list. Now we can run our first request again and get a list of all our items. Now to delete an item from our list, let's pick one of our UUIDs, insert it into the request, and run it. The server responded with status OK, and as we run our first query again, we can see our item is gone. Alright guys, that's it for this video, and I hope you've learned something today. If you liked this video, feel free to leave me a like down below. Have a nice day and happy coding!